Welcome to this talk about Docker Container Loader. Thanks a lot for this warm welcome from Peter. And yeah, now I know also that it's not my birthday, but my open source baby's birthday. So it's nice to know that as well. What can you expect today? So I'm talking about Docker containers. So I will present you 10 different ways how you can create Docker images. So this is the road trip which you can expect for the next 30 minutes. It will be quite a fast trip, I can promise. So I will give only more or less an overview of these technologies. And this is more 10,000 feet overview, so I can barely scratch the surface. But I hope I can give you still the idea behind these methods. So now let's start a little bit. So we all know Docker, of course. We know that Docker is based on containers, or better, let's say, like images from which the containers are created. And there are two ways how you can create typically Docker images. So these are the standard ways what you can do. You can do the way that you start a container, you stop it, and then you commit the container to make an image out of it. This is, of course, normally not recommended because it's not so easy reproducible. So you cannot reproduce the image itself if you it depends on what you are doing within the container. But we will see later that it still makes sense to use this technology to create images, Docker images, out of that. But the normal way how you are doing Docker images these days is with a Docker file, which is a more or less a small script with a limited set of keywords for creating Docker images. You all know Docker files. You have a base image. You run commands within it. You can add some metadata, like what ports your images are exposing. And then you have an entry point or a command to start the container. Okay, this is all we know. And then the question is, of course, why is this not enough? So why are people now trying to say, okay, it's all good, it's all easy, it's very, very simple to use, but they are not really, it's not a fit for all environments and for all contexts. One of the reasons what a problem is with this Docker file approach is that there is currently no way how to make compositions within Docker files. So normally you have inheritance, you have base images, you can make an inheritance hierarchy of Docker images. This is quite easy. But you cannot put in some components within a Docker file which you can reuse in another Docker file. Also you know this problem, composition over inheritance, and this is much more flexible to make some sort of includes like that. Say like that. So there's no intrinsic support for that one. Then sometimes you need to have some variation of Docker files, something not, maybe we will see later some example of this. But so you want to have some sort of parameters for Docker files. You know there is support of it for this. This is called build args, which you can use to give some arguments, which they are then filled in during the build time. But there are some, for example, there are some limitations of this intrinsic template mechanism of Dockerfile, because you cannot, for example, parameterize the from image, the base image, so you cannot simply change the base image within build org. Then you have really no influence how you can group layers at the moment, so every statement within the Dockerfile results into an image in a layer. Of course, it would be nice simply to group things together, because if you have some temporary steps which you want to clean up, you know all the tricks with this double ampersand to concatenate comments together. But yeah, this is more or less some sort of hackish style to influence the number of layers you are creating for the Docker file. Yeah, and then it's also some security is often a concern, because normally if you run a Docker file, then of course the containers start and it runs under a user root, and if you're a multi-tenant environment, this often poses some security issues. Okay, now let's go to some of the examples how to solve these kind of problems. One of them is an approach called Dockerfile template, and this technique is quite easy to understand, because what you are doing, you have a set of templates and you create Dockerfiles out of these templates. So it's a sort of pre-processing step which you are using. As I said, there's a simple built-in support with this build args. The arg is a keyword within the Dockerfile which you can use. But there are a lot of other external engines which you can use to create these sort of Dockerfiles. I've listed here some of these examples. And I will look into one of them a little bit closer. It's called Fish Pepper. And here you see my chili pepper larf. So when I do a new open source project, I typically call it after some kind of pepper. Pepper name. Fish pepper is also a very it's not famous, but it's a pepper from the east side of US coast. So it's and it, fish, of course, there's a nice association to the Docker whale. Okay, this is a template-based system based on Node.js. The special thing about this one is that it's multi-dimensional, which means that you can create a lot of similar, a whole family of Docker builds. A good use case, good example for this one is if you want to create a base image, let's say a Java base image, but you wanted to have it for Java 7, 8, and 9, and you want maybe to have a variation which contains a JDK, the full Java development kit, but also maybe only the Java runtime environment, the JRE. And then you want to maybe want to base it on CentOS and Alpine or maybe some other Linux-based systems. And if you now count the possibilities how you can combine these parameters, you end up with 12 or so. Yeah. And this, the traditional approach is that you create a Docker file and then you copy over all these Docker files and then make small changes within the Docker file simply to adopt it. But this is, of course, not not easy maintainable, because if you change something, you have to change it 12 times. It's not easy. Then we will see also an example in a minute. Then it supports fragments. Fragments are this sort of some sort of blocks which you can include in the Docker files. And then it has additional support not only for creating the Docker files itself, but also to trigger some builds and pushes to a registry. Okay, here's an example of such a template. You know, this is a template language based on, it's called DOT in the Node.js, where you have some sort of context parameters, and these things within the curly braces are then inserted during the template run. And the end result is that you here, in that case, as you have a simple set of templates. It's only it's cut over here. And then you get a whole family of images which are all looking quite the same. And this template engine not only replaces the part in the Docker file, but also in the supporting file. So you can, for example, this README, and you have different variations with the different parameters. So you fish pepper simply will iterate over Alpine, CentOS, JBoss, OpenJDK 7, OpenJDK 8, JDK, and JRE, and create for all these combinations the corresponding files, which you then can, of course, check in. And if you set up a Docker Hub build with this, then you get 12 images out of one set of templates. This approach is quite good for base images, of course. And we use it for, so I'm, as I said, I'm in the, so I haven't said it, but I'm in the Fabricate team at Red Hat, where we are doing developer tooling around Kubernetes and OpenShift. And we also have this set of Java base images, and you can use them for your own Java projects, for example. This was the sort of template engine and other approaches, which is completely different, but it's also quite interesting. Now it's called Ansible Container. This is a quite interesting thing, because there you simply you do not use any Docker files for creating images, but this works differently. So in that case you use Ansible to create Docker images, which is quite interesting, because normally you say, okay, Ansible is something somewhat in doesn't fit well with Docker. But here the idea is that you use, I just start with, here is some sort of example how it works. So with Ansible container, you start first some set of base containers, like you do. And you define it in some sort of description file, like container JAML. And then you create an Ansible inventory, which is simply a set of hosts, which points to these containers. And after that, you run your Ansible playbook, which is a set of instructions to say to provision within the container. So you can use all Ansible machinery to install stuff within your running container. And the interesting thing here is that you don't need to, so the question is, of course, how can Ansible put things into the container? How can it contact the container? And with Ansible container, it does it simply with Docker exec and Docker copy. So only with Docker means, so you don't need any SSH daemon, for example, running within. The only prerequisite for this technology is to have Python on the container, because Ansible needs Python to run within the container. So it's a very lightweight way how you can provision in the container. It's agentless, as Ansible is anyway, but you don't even need any SSH for that way. And after the provisioning is done, you stop the container, and then you make this commit, this dirty thing, which I've shown on the first slide, where you simply commit a container, make an image out of this container again, so that after that, you can reuse this image to create other containers, which are then already provisioned. This is, of course, no problem with respect to reproducibility, because, of course, Ansible is, you know, it's a CI system which guarantees you that you can make reproducible. Sorry. Okay, it's an open source project. It's now, I think, it's already moved to an official Ansible project, so you can get it from the Ansible website. Now to the third way, how to build images. There's a tool called Pekka. I think most of you probably know Pekka. Pekka is a tool out of the HashiCorp universe, where you know, we already heard about Vault, but you know probably mostly HashiCorp is mostly not up for Recurrent, which is an easy way to create virtual machines. And Pekka is something, is a tool for creating machine images. So it's used for creating, for example, AMI images for EC2 or maybe VirtualBox appliances, which you can use then to start up. So it consists of several parts. So one is the builder part, which simply technology. It's an abstraction over building, like starting these easy AMI builder. And Docker is one of these builders. So you can start again a container. Then you can choose some sort of provisioner. So it's not only Ansible, but you can use anything: shell, Puppet, Chef. To again, so that the idea is the same as for Ansible container. So you provision within to this container, and afterwards you make a commit and have a sort of post-processing where you can even do pushing to a registry or make some tagging. The thing here is that here you require SSH. So this is different to the Ansible container thing. So if you are using Ansible, of course, I would recommend to use Ansible container because it's more lightweight. If you are using some other sort of provisioning system, and you can of course reuse all your cookbooks like for Chef or so, then this is also a good alternative to create your images. Now you see we are really quite fast in this road trip. There's another technology now, something again completely different. It's called the Rocker. This is it's an open source tool, and in this case it's really an extension to a Docker file. So Rocker introduces new keywords which you can use for create your Docker images. Docker file is also a valid Rocker file, so it's somewhat backwards compatible, but it introduces new syntax and also some new semantics. For example, you can use multiple froms in your Docker file, which you then can use to really to put also your build process within to Docker. As I show you in the next slide, that's an example of what I mean. You can also simply tag and push directly from the Rocker file, so you can input the metadata stored in Docker file itself. This is also sometimes really an issue because you have the Docker file and then you have to put the name and the text outside of the Docker file. So this is something, and here you can combine it into one single file. This is nice, and it also supports templating, similar to this thing which I've shown with Fish Pepper. Here's an example how it looks like. So you have here some two froms. So one is from a Go base image, and you simply add your source code, you create your executable, and then you have this export. This export then can reuse in the second part here with an import and simply add it to the second image. So you create two images, but actually your application image is really only the later one, and it's quite slim because it doesn't contain the build tools, for example. It only contains the things to start up. So you can easily specify in one single step with a single file also your build and then the creation of your image. So, next one. Build integration. So we have now seen how you can create images. But again, we have, when you are doing Java, for example, Java application building, then you have often the problem that you create your Java artifacts, which are jar files or war files or other things, and then you have to put them into a Docker container. And then, of course, you can use a Docker file, you can create your Docker image, you can push it, but you have, again, you have two set of tools. One is your Java build tool, which is maybe Maven, maybe Gradle, maybe even End, and then there is your Docker build tool, yeah, and you have to. It's not self-contained itself because you have to install several things. So it would be nice to have some sort of build integration into your Java build. Of course, if Docker could build Java applications, that would be also a solution. But I don't think this will ever happen. Okay, so you, build integration is a nice thing, and here's an example. It's really not the only way how you can do it. You can use Gradle, as I said. There are also plugins for Gradle, which is a Java build system. Maven is a Java build system, and even there are several Maven plugins which you can use. This Docker Maven plugin is the one which I get the cake for. So this is already 3 years old, and there's another tool which is more or less the big sister of the Docker Maven plugin. It's called the Fabricate Maven plugin. With this Docker Maven plugin, it's quite easy to create Docker images directly out of your build. So you specify, you have in your build, in your Java build, you specify all the build information needed for creating your Java application. And then you add some extra information for how to put it into a container. You can use a so-called Maven assembly to refer to all the dependencies of this Java applications, all the dependent jars, which you also put into the image. And then you create an image. You don't need an external Docker client because this plugin talks directly with the Docker daemon. This is quite nice. It's quite easy to set up as well. And this is a good way to use it into your Java build process. And also, this plugin also knows how to start Docker images, which is especially useful if you're running integration tests. This is a nice thing too. The next thing is the Fabricate Maven plugin. As I said, it's a big sister of the Docker Maven plugin. And this can create Docker images as well, but it does something additional. It creates automatically Kubernetes and OpenShift descriptors, which you can use to deploy your application on an OpenShift or Kubernetes cluster. And again, the image configuration is created out of the build information, which is contained in the POM XML. And the nice thing is it also knows about the so-called zero configuration mode, which is an addition to the Docker Maven plugin, which means in a simple case, it's sufficient to really to declare this plugin within your POM XML, and all the other things are inferred from the rest of the POM XML. For example, if you are running a Spring Boot application, which is some sort of Java microservices framework, then this plugin really detects that there's a Spring Boot Maven plugin. It knows where Spring Boot saves their ports for exposing your Java microservice. It knows where Spring Boot declares their health checks. It's done with Accurator. It chooses a sort of Java base image, which was one of the I've shown you previously in the slides, and then automatically creates the image. So this you can use to create a Docker image with very opinionated defaults, say it's like that. It's similar to Spring Boot for the microservices world. So you can create, if you are satisfied with the defaults we have selected for you, then you are really, you simply put in the dependency and you are done. This is also quite nice. And by the way, it's also planned that this auto detection facility will be backported to the Docker Maven plugin. So that if you're not using Kubernetes or OpenShift in a future version of the Docker Maven plugin, you can use this directly only with this Docker Maven plugin. So, okay, now this was really a round trip around the ways how you can create Docker images locally on your computer. This is, of course, no comprehensive overview, but these are simply some ways I'm aware of. I'm pretty sure there are more of this, but I think these were the most important ones. But the other big category how you can create Docker images is that you do it remotely. And one way is, of course, you all know it, it's Docker Hub. It's a public Docker registry, but it's also some sort of build system. So you automatically can create Docker images within Docker Hub. You can trigger these builds simply with a manual trigger. So you simply push a button. That's the easy way. You can set up a GitHub webhook so that every time you make a commit into your GitHub repository, this build is triggered on Docker Hub and then automatically creates the image. You can also chain builds together to say, maybe you have some sort of base image there and some image which depends on this base image. And you can chain them on Docker Hub so that when the base image is recreated, then also your dependent image is recreated. This is also quite nice to, for example, if you detect some sort of security fix in your base image, you can automatically re-trigger all the builds of your application images as well. And these days, also nice is that you can make multiple builds and also based on directory, tag, and branch. So you can say, okay, you can use the Git tag also as part of the Docker image name, the Docker tag. So this is simply can easily be done with some sort of pattern language. So probably you have also seen this. Okay, this is an easy way, and we use it all for our Java-based images as well. It works quite nicely. Another way how you can create images from within the cloud is to do it with a continuous integration. And of course, so which means that you have a CI system which creates the Docker images for you. There are one of the most popular ones is Jenkins, but you know there's also other CI systems like GitLab or and all of these have some sort of facility how you can create Docker images during a CI run. This is quite common. But what also is it's not new, but it's also quite convenient is to have that you have these public CI services like Travis or Circle CI, which all provide a means to create Docker images during this continuous integration run. I have here a sample for a Circle CI, where you simply define some sort of services, which is in that case it's called, of course, Docker. And then you have, so this is a Circle CI specific syntax. You put this in a file, you check this into your top level directory of your GitHub project. You set up some sort of webhooks, and then Circle CI, every time you make a commit, creates or runs this continuous integration job. You can also say you have different triggers, like to say, okay, check in on the master branch, then these commands should be executed. Or if you check in a release, a tag, for example, then the next sort of steps should be created. What you here see is there are some tricks which might be interesting for you if you're doing it that way, that you, of course, you shouldn't automatically create and push images if you get a pull request, because then normally Circle CI is also triggered as well. And and this one, this trick here with this pipe cut minus means simply you force Docker to run in a non-TTY mode, which simply do not mess up your log files for the continuous integration job. Otherwise, you get a lot of escape characters like there. So this was only just of these goodies. Okay, then there's now we are leaving this thing of the plain Docker image service build services and have now something which is called Google Cloud Container Builder, which is also quite new. It's a service from Google, of course, which is part of their Google Cloud services, and it's in which is tightly integrated in the Google universe. So it uses the Google Container Engine, for example. It uses the Google Container Registry for, so you create images and they will be automatically stored in the Google Container Registry, which is another registry available from Google. And of course, this Google Container Registry has a tight integration in the Google Container Engine. So this is something which is really very nice if you are running within Google. And how does this Google Cloud Container Builder works? This Google Cloud Container Builder, a very lengthy word, has a concept of so-called build steps. And every build step in this Google Cloud Container Builder is a Docker container on its own. So you can easily create, here's an example. You give some sort of description file. You have certain kind of steps. And each step references a build step, which is perfect. which is a container. The container is run with these arguments. And then you simply say at the end of the build, so these steps are supposed to create images within a Docker daemon. And at the end, you say which of these created images are really the images you want to push to the Google Container Registry. And so you can have multiple ones. You can, of course, create your own builder steps quite easily, because it's nothing else like a container which is run with some sort of arguments. And you get, as you can see, you put in your the data, so what you want to build during the run. So here you are using G Cloud, which is simply the command line tool for interacting with the Google Cloud. And then you have here a reference to Google Cloud Storage, which is here simply this GS thing. And this build will simply pick this archive, extract it, and then run this, mount it somehow within this builder step. And at the end, it pushes the generated image back to the Google Container Registry. Okay, so what I have to say, just one slide back. There are a lot of fixed already given steps which you can reuse. And Docker is, of course, is the most prominent. So Docker, this Docker build image simply is there for creating image Docker images at the end. Okay, now let's come to the final way. So now we are at number 10, how you can create images within the cloud. So this is called OpenShift source to image, which is a part of OpenShift. You might know that OpenShift itself is a platform, orchestration platform on top of Kubernetes. So it's simply an add-on of Kubernetes and adds, let's say, the so-called build aspect to Kubernetes, which allows you to do the build of your applications and of your images within the platform itself. It has some technologies for doing this. The important one is source to image, which means that you have two parameters, which is your source code itself, which can be some sort of GitHub URL, or you can provide an archive on your own. And then you have a builder image. So it's a little bit similar to the way how it was done in the previous slide for this Google Container Builder. So you have source code, you have a builder image, and what happens is here, in this example, you have a command line tool, OC. This is the equivalent of kubectl, which you can use, and you have OC new app, and then you see here, you have two parts which are separated by this tilde there. So the first part specifies a builder image, and the second part specifies the source URL. Then you start the builder container. The builder container is supposed to have a certain structure. So there are expected that there are some so-called scripts at certain locations. One is a sample script, which is then, so the builder container is started, then within the container, the source code is checked out. And then the build is run. This depends, of course, on the builder, how it is supposed to do. So there are builder containers which do no build at all, like PHP or Ruby. Another one, like Java, have to do a lot of things to create your artifacts. And when you are done with the build, the container is stopped again, and again it's committed to an image, to the application image, and this application image then can be deployed to the OpenShift orchestra application, so like your as a deployment. So you have no direct contact with any Docker daemon. The good thing is, of course, since OpenShift has full control over the builder, it has also full control over the security. So it can really, the builder container, these builders are really very, have very restricted capabilities, so it's quite secure, though. So you cannot break out via some sort of malicious build. Let's say you have a Docker file which tries to compromise your system, doesn't work it because you have no Docker file. You have no direct Docker build here. Interaction there. Yeah, so I'm at the end of the talk, so I hope it was not too fast. So the idea again, as I said, was that I wanted to give an overview of the ways how you can create Docker images. And I say Docker files are really okay. So it's not something that I say I want to bash Docker files here, or to say Docker files are a bad thing. So it's really, 90% of the cases, it's completely sufficient to use Docker files for making Docker images. But in the rest of the 10%, it might be interesting to know what's out there and what people are doing. As there are many alternative ways to creating Docker images. And of course, for you, you can, so it's also quite some fun to play around with these technologies, and yeah, so that's it. First of all, thank you for your attention.